International observers are in the country to monitor the May 13 elections. Here's a look at what they're zeroing in on voting day.
International observers will be in six different areas in the country on election day. At least 30 people will be part of the 2013 International Observers Mission, or the so-called International Team Bantay. The observers are training their sights on a number of heated local electoral battles with a history of election-related violence, fraud, and political clans. These include electoral races in Pampanga, the 3rd District of Camarines Sur, the ARMM, and a three-way fight for the governorship of Masbate. The international observers who come from 16 different countries will be grouped according to their expertise and experience in election monitoring for the 10-day mission. After the elections, the international observers will return to Manila to craft their monitoring report, which will be presented to the public, concerned government agencies, and the diplomatic corps.
All right, joining us on Hot Coffee, Leif Pettersen and Marie Norden are both with us. Both Swedish members of parliament and international election observers for the Compact for Peaceful and Democratic Elections, or Compact. They're both veteran election observers in other countries, while Leif has observed Philippine elections 5 times and he keeps coming back. Good day to you, Leif. Good morning.
Good morning.
And Marie.
Good morning.
All right. Okay. So wait, you've been here 5 times?
Oh, I've been here for several more times.
Several more
Perhaps
times.
20 times.
To observe the elections?
No. To just been here in the Philippines.
Okay. But to observe the elections 5 times?
Well, actually, this is the first time I really am observing elections.
Yes.
But, you know, I've been here during election times and,
okay,
and things like that.
All right. Now tell me, I'm going to ask both of you, because you've been all over the world. I mean, of all the times you've been in the Philippines, have you observed or seen a change prior to Election Day, even in terms of campaigning?
Yeah.
Or the environment?
Yeah, I think so. The change in Philippines are due to, well, who is the president, of course, and because the president has so much to say all in Philippine politics.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's... You can see a total change now from the previous president to the sitting.
What is the change that you see from president Arroyo to Aquino?
Well, it's calmer. It's so to say going in a more social way. More social reforms are put forward, and I think. The present administration is, for me, they're doing a better job than the previous.
Oh, really? Okay, they're going to want to hear that. They watch the show. All right. Now, Marie, it's your first time in the Philippines.
Yes, it is.
All right, so it's hot.
It's hot, but I love it.
Okay.
It's nice.
All right, okay. Now, you've been a member of parliament, I mean, for how many years?
It's
I'm just curious.
Almost 10 years now.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And did you last observe the elections anytime this year?
The last time I was, I think it was Belarus,
okay,
in last year. So I've been to many other countries.
Yeah. Now, well, what will you be looking for on May 13? Where will you be?
We will be in
Masbate.
Masbate.
Yeah, we'll
okay.
leave tomorrow. Yeah. And we will be looking at what happens during election day. Mm. I think that's important to say that we are looking for what happens in the polling stations. If people are allowed to vote in the
okay.
proper way, that they're not, that people are not trying to force them to vote in a different way.
Okay.
If they have time in the polling station, and so.
Mm-mm. Why did you choose Masbate?
We didn't choose Masbate. They actually chose it for us.
Okay.
So, and it's always nice to leave the bigger cities. I know that's a lot of people living there as well. But I always find that it's good to leave the head cities.
All right. I'm going to ask you some feedback. Money ban. You've heard about the money ban
yes.
at
yes.
the Comelec?
Yes.
Is that normal?
No, I never heard about it before.
Really?
No,
no other countries had a money ban?
No, they should have, but I think the thinking around money ban is they put it on the table and say, we know that you are paying voters to vote for you. So I think that's good that they really address that, because you have it in other countries as well. And I think that's really a big problem. But money ban is, that's new. I never heard about it.
Okay.
No, never.
But is it a good idea?
Well, it might be. But then again, it's not for us to say because, you know, it's so much about the context it's put in. So
I
don't know.
I can understand the commerce, the thinking people won't have money to actually buy things. So I think that's a big problem. So, but it's not for us to say that what if it's good or bad. But I think it's good that you actually address the problem, that you know that candidates are paying voters. And I think that's a big, I think that should be.
Okay.
If you want to stop it, I think that's good.
That should be banned. That should be banned.
That should be banned. What about the liquor ban?
That's new as well.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I understand
why. There are no drunkards in other countries.
They are. Actually, you know, if you go to some countries like Belarus, I've seen people getting a drink after they've been voting. And I think that's a big problem, of course. But so I think it's quite brave to say, well, we ban liquor for these days because we need you to be sober before and during election day.
Yeah, you know, when I was in Ukraine, even those who were in charge of the voting process
were drunk.
Yeah.
Mm. Oh my God.
Sometimes you can
see. One of the precincts I went to, I'm sure that the chairman of the precinct was sitting somewhere in the garden being drunk.
Okay. So in all these countries, after you've observed, it does make sense that these ideas are out there.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, in Sweden, if you're drunk and you come and vote, you are able to vote.
Yeah, you're not banned from voting. But I think it's brave of that you actually stress it and say, we know that people do this and we need you to be sober, we need you to take part of the election. I think more countries should think the same way. So I don't think it's
okay.
A good
now, thing. Are other countries as colorful during election day? I mean, you can see the level of mistrust in this country.
Yeah.
There's a brownout and it's attributed to a conspiracy theory when it could have been just a natural problem.
Yeah.
Is it like this in other countries?
Well, no, I think not in the same way. Mm. Not in the same way. But of course, there are a lot of mistrusts against politicians and things like that. And in some of the Eastern European countries where we have been, I mean, the trust in politicians is really low.
Yes,
really low.
Really
in
low.
Ukraine, you know, they jailed the opposition leader, Yulia Tymoshenko. She is now in jail. Accused of murder or you know, but everything is a political process, but you have an interesting election day ahead of you, I think.
Yes, Marie.
Yeah, I think that the distrust and in some countries, you know that my vote's not going to make a difference. And I don't think you have that problem here in Philippines, that you know that you actually, if I vote and if we get together and do something, we will make a difference and we can decide if our candidate will be chosen. But in some countries, you know that it's a setup from the beginning.
I see. Well, I'm curious, what countries are those?
I think that if you go to Kazakhstan, when the last president election, you had three other candidates. Just prior to the election day, they actually, all of them said that, well, we actually don't want to be president. I'm not sure I'm going to vote for myself either. So they actually run to make sure that it looked better for the preceding president.
Yes.
So then you know as a voter that it's just a setup. It doesn't matter if I vote for another candidate. I'm still going to end up with the same president as always.
Now, are you familiar with the PCOS machine, the Smartmatic machine?
No, I have never seen them before. That's
You've never?
For me. No, that's the first time I come to a country where they have machines like this.
Really? But it's automated in all the other countries you've been to?
No.
Really?
It's almost manual in all the countries I got. No, all the countries I've been to, it's been manual, like you put a cross and so on.
Yeah. Now, I'm curious, they say that even Germany wants to go back to manual. Do most European countries want to go back to manual?
They haven't been to automatic. They haven't had the snow. They have
really?
The snow, yeah.
So you mean to say in Sweden, when you vote, the counting is manual?
Yeah,
of course.
Yes.
How long does it take for you to know the winner?
Well, in all the countries I've been
to,
and in Sweden,
an hour in Sweden, it's manual and you know?
No, you have like the first counting, and it takes about after the election. Then you have the polls to give a signal. And then you takes about a couple of hours.
Yeah, something like that.
Okay.
But same night, you know.
But you know the precincts are up to 1,200
voters.
Yeah, it's
not that big. So it takes
and it's counted on the precinct level and then reported upwards in the system.
Yeah.
So it's automated.
No?
At some point.
Not automated.
Mm. Oh, okay. Now is manual more dangerous? I mean, is it more prone to cheating than automation?
It could be, but not in our system. You could say waterproof.
In Sweden, I think we have a function. Our system is working, but you can see in other countries that you actually have packs of ballots.
Yes,
like in stacks. You can see.
Really?
You can see. I've seen it. So you can see that people have been cheating. That someone has been putting 10 or 20 or 30 polls of ballots in the voting box. You have the problem. So I think that the automatic system can be more secure from cheating. Yeah.
All right. So you've never seen this machine.
No.
You don't know what it looks like.
No.
Okay. I wish I can interview you after the elections.
Yeah.
We'll invite you over. The PCOS machine is secret voting. Mm-hmm. But also secret counting.
Yeah.
You don't know what it's counting.
No.
That's why there is a strong level of distrust. You put the ballot in, and then you are trusting that the machine is counting what you wrote, and not any other name. You cannot see it.
Will you get a receipt when you?
You don't get a receipt. So the only thing you get after the ballot goes in is congratulations, you voted. Mm. That's it.
Well.
No receipt. You have no copy of what it's counted. Mm-hmm. After the voting, when the polls close, the PCOS machine will be closed. Then it starts to count.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Then it comes out with a tally. So there's a card inside that, mm-hmm. and the source code that instructs the machine how to read it, etc. Mm-hmm. But the beef of many people is that you can't see how the machine is counting.
No. But that's a problem.
But if you had a receipt, then it would be okay.
When you have polls outside the polling station, that where you ask people who did you vote for, and so you can, because that is could be a way to compare
exit polls.
Yeah. Exactly. Do you have that?
We have that here, but it's private networks that do it, like us.
Yeah.
We did that for the presidential race.
In some countries, you have NGOs standing outside doing exit polls, so you actually can compare the outcome from the polling station with the outcome of this exit polls, because then you have some comparison.
Yes, but it's pretty expensive to do exit polls here.
You need to have NGOs and people who work voluntarily.
Yeah. So. All right. What kind of cheating are you expecting?
Well, I hope most of the times they don't cheat. But we already heard about the people getting paid.
Yes.
So that's cheating. So we don't. And we won't be seeing that in the polling station, because then the cheating has already been there.
We don't expect anyone to stand outside the polling station,
no,
putting out money to people.
I don't think they're going to do
that. Yes,
I don't think so.
But disenfranchisement. No, but in the Philippines, you might be able to see it.
Huh?
Okay.
I mean, it might not be right outside the polling places, but I mean, if you go like to the little neighborhoods around it, you might be able to see. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm curious, a disenfranchisement. How do they do it in other countries?
Disenfranchisement.
When you want to ensure that someone doesn't vote.
Oh, well, I think you...
Or they can't vote.
Yeah, I think people get threatened before, so... But it's very difficult to actually know if people just stay home, the reason why they don't vote. So, so I think you threaten people, that's all, and... You,
yeah, that's the common way.
Mm-hmm.
But... I don't know. For us, it's not a familiar situation, because we urge everyone to go vote.
Yeah. What country were you most impressed with among all your travels in terms of how they conduct elections?
Sweden.
I would say that all the countries I've been to. I'm always impressed about the people working in the polling station, really trying to do a really good job, because Most of the times, they really wanted to be fair elections.
Do teachers do it also yeah. teachers?
Yes.
Yeah,
yeah. Most of the times you go to school, and most of the time the headmaster in the school also are the head commissioner of the polling station. So, and I think that I'm always impressed about the almost mostly women working in the election. I think that's
very
amazing
so.
That they stay there for more than 12 hours. And they stayed all day, and they really want to do a good job. And I think I've been impressed about that in Belarus, in Moldova, in Albania, Kazakhstan. They always want to do a good job.
Yeah, well, if I should
pick a country.
Yeah, well, Norway.
Norway, okay. Right. Why is that?
Well, you know, Sweden and Norway is almost
the same.
The same, almost the same. And I think, but then there are some differences, but you can see that they try to do it in a proper way, and they try to ban cheating in every way. So, and I think it's about the mindset, mm-hmm. but you have to, so to say, think that this should be fair. We should do it in a fair way.
True.
But then it's much easier to do it also.
Yeah.
No, but if you think of cheating, if you think in that way, then you always try to find ways to cheat, to run around the system, so to say. And then you're not a part of the system. You're part of something else.
How do you change a culture of cheating? Because in the Philippines, there's a running joke. Nobody ever loses. They've always been cheated.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I mean? No, you'll never hear a candidate say, yeah, you know what? I lost that election. I mean, this fair and square, that person really won. Yeah. It's always, I've been cheated. Mm. I've been cheated. How do you change that mindset?
Well, you know, by being frank and open, by having a transparent system, by showing everyone that this has been done in a proper way. But if you all the time suspect that someone is or can manipulate the system as a whole, then you will always have that suspicion that I've been cheated.
Yes.
No, it wasn't fair.
That's a good point. When you suspect someone or an entity can manipulate something in this country, I mean, they feel that members of the COMELEC can manipulate or Smartmatic because they have control, etc. I understand, okay. Martin.
I think that if you have the more election observers you actually have before the election and during election day, and also afterwards making the analysis why and how it ended up the way it did, I think that's the way to actually get more trust in the system. So you can say, even if you lose, I wasn't cheated. There was a fair election. And I think you should be, as Leif said, the transparency has to be fully open, and you should be able to see what happened. And I think that's the main way to go, actually.
Now, in other countries, all the countries you've observed, they do popular voting, or was there any other country that does electoral votes like the United States?
No, actually, no, I haven't.
Never, it's all popular voting.
Yeah, in Europe, it's that system is in every country, I think.
Yeah.
Okay.
But then again, if you should have that, you have to have a very good knowledge about how many people who are living there and who is living where and everything like that.
Now, does it help or is it bad for us that during election day, this is a midterm election, we vote for 12 senators, one congressman, one mayor? I mean, do we vote for councillors too?
Yes.
Councillors, I think six. Are they six or 12? Six. Mm. I mean, they're all in the ballot. Mm. So at a party list group, you're voting for at least 20 people.
Yeah. Mm. Well, we have a different system, you know. Yeah. We have a party list system all through. So when you vote, you take a party's ballot. That party's ballot and put it in an envelope, and then you put it in the ballot.
It's not necessarily bad that you had to vote for all these different institutions
but
in the same time.
But it's very personality driven.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And I think it's important that I think that the percentages that will choose the vote, it's going to rise, because you go to one election day and then vote all these So the important thing is that it's easy, it's not complicated, that you know that when I voted for this, the Congress and the Senate and the mayor, you shouldn't be able to mix it up in the ballot.
Yes.
That's, I think, most important.
Are we the only country you've seen that we have senators on a national scale?
No.
There are?
Yeah. Yes.
Others really
For instance, Ireland.
Ireland, the senators are of a national scale.
Yeah.
Because, I mean,
well, no,
in the
no,
United
no,
States,
no,
it's
no.
statewide.
Yeah.
Only.
I was surprised that you actually had it on a national scale. Most of the time you come from your region.
I was going to say that.
There's so many. I thought that you actually would divide it up in the constituencies.
Yes.
I wasn't surprised by that.
Exactly.
Because it must be hard to get to know them. There's just too many.
There are 24.
But on a national scale.
Well, 100 million people?
But on
24?
A national scale, yeah. So imagine what would
the
happen.
The national scale is the problem.
The national scale is the problem because if your senators are on a national scale, they'll have to spend on a national scale every time they run.
Mm. Yeah.
Some of them spend to run for the Senate how much a president would spend or a vice president.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the point.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
It's a lot of money.
Yeah.
All right, now, in terms of cost, what have you observed? I mean, of course, there is, a limitation for voter in the Philippines of how much you can spend. But frankly speaking, I honestly can tell you they do not follow it.
No.
Yeah. In fact, there's a now there is no limitation on the ad ban of TV commercials. So if you have so much money, you can have all the TV commercials.
A nail shop yesterday, and I saw this on TV, and I saw all these commercials, and I thought to myself, this must be really expensive.
Yeah.
So, but we arrived yesterday, so we haven't seen that much spending. Actually.
Okay.
So.
Now, in other countries, what would be the rule?
Well, you know,
I haven't seen any limited amount how much you're allowed to spend on commercials.
Okay.
So, I think the ban, or the amount is set on how much you're allowed to give someone, or so.
Oh, really?
But if you say that, you have to be transparent.
As a donor?
Yes.
As a donor?
Yeah.
Okay, so how much are you allowed to give? I'm curious.
In Sweden, we don't have a ban. You can give as much as you want.
Like $1 billion?
Yeah, if you want to, yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Isn't that dangerous?
We are working for a legislation that you actually need to tell, as a party, you need to tell who gave us money.
Yes, in the United States, they have that.
Yeah, they have that.
In fact,
they have a better legislation, actually, than we have.
Yeah.
No,
there was a donor, a Filipino donor, was actually put in jail for not declaring his $40,000 donation to Bill Clinton.
Oh my God.
Okay.
Yeah. So there is.
We don't have that in Sweden.
What about all the other countries you've observed?
I haven't. They haven't addressed that. They haven't, no.
So I'm curious before we go to a break.
Because many of the countries actually don't get time on TV because they have more like state TV, and they say sometimes they don't get commercials, and sometimes they have all each 5 minutes or so.
Yes,
so they have that kind.
Fair.
Yeah, they try to be.
In Sweden, we are not allowed to have political commercials on TV.
Really?
Yeah, not.
There are no. What about Norway? All the other countries you've been to.
Norway, the same, I think.
No political ads on TV.
We don't have that tradition, no.
So how do you make yourself known to the public?
By talking to people.
Yeah.
You travel all over the country?
Well,
in our
constituencies.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's not possible here if you're a senator.
No.
So you really have the national...
Yeah.
You have
to...
You have the commercial on cinema.
You're allowed to.
On cinemas and in the newspapers and you know...
Yeah. But not TV.
Radio. Not TV.
Radio.
Not TV.
How interesting, really.
And commercial radio also.
Yeah.
Why not TV, but the rest, okay?
Because we have this long tradition not having it, so I think that's the reason. We haven't had commercial TV for that long.
Okay.
So we...
I'm curious, are you both from the same party?
Yes, we are.
Okay, now, did you both campaign yourselves? Or So when people vote for the party...
They can also make...
Choose who's in.
Yeah.
I see. Okay, so you don't vote for a party, and then the party chooses who's in.
No, you have a list.
You have a list.
I
see.
Yes.
Okay.
But,
okay.
But the voter can put a mark in a box in front of one of the names, and if that name has enough marks, he or she will be the first. Yeah.
Okay.
The list.
And how long are you in office?
Well, 10 years for me.
Well, four years.
The term is 4 years, yeah.
The term is 4 years
each.
I see. And is there a limitation to the term?
No.
Really?
No.
Because in the Philippines, I think you can only be a congressman. How many terms? 3 terms.
Yeah.
Yeah, if not, they hold on to power forever. I mean, I don't blame
you. We have colleagues that sat for 30 years. So we...
Okay. All right. We're going to take a quick break. When we return, we'll continue our conversation with Compact Poll observers Leif Pettersen and Marie Norden. Hot Copy will be right back. Welcome back to Hot Copy. With us are Leif Pettersen and Marie Norden, both Swedish members of parliament, or it should be both members of the Swedish parliament.
Yes.
And international elections observers for Compact. All right. Now, You've said something good, is that the environment has improved in the Philippines, all right? Particularly because of the administration.
I think so.
Yeah. How do we reach a point wherein it's not administration-based, it's not based on a person, but it's really institution-driven?
I think it's about transparency. I think it's very much about that. People have to have trust in the system, and they can only have trust in the system if they can see what's going on. And I think that's really crucial.
And I think to work with corruption is really important. That you should know that it's not possible to buy a deal with someone in the administration by giving money and having money is not a deal breaker to actually get your right in the system. So I think that's really important.
Now, in the countries that you've been to, have you seen election violence related incidents?
Yeah.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. I've seen in front days before, you have violent riots, and candidates have been put in jail and getting beaten because in Belarus they have a big problem when
is there a gun ban in other countries?
No, there's not. So that's
really?
No. There should be, I think. But
is that good that we have a gun ban?
They have a gun ban in the... If you say it's not, you're not allowed to bring a gun in the
so
polling station, so that's the gun ban they have, of course.
Okay, but that you're not allowed to bring in the polling stations, like you were saying.
Yeah, I said, but who cares? In the Philippines, everyone has a gun, I think.
Really? I didn't know
well,
that. Oh my God.
Very many people have guns.
Yeah, it's true. Sadly.
Yeah, sadly.
Yeah.
I think you shouldn't have to have guns, actually.
Yes.
If everyone said, okay, let's put it down.
There was a whole debate on whether or not we should stop the permit to carry, issue a total gun ban.
Yeah.
But they were saying that you can't issue a total gun ban when criminals have guns.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, criminals have guns everywhere in the world, but it's not about that. It's about common people having guns. That's actually the threat.
The risk is to get killed. You're more likely to get killed with your own gun and then other guns. So it's the countries who have a lot of guns, like United States and the Philippines, then you can see that people are actually getting killed by these guns, not the bad guys' guns.
So in Sweden there is a gun ban.
Well,
you're
allowed to have guns.
Yeah, you don't. But you're not. I mean, like, do you have a gun?
You're not allowed. You're not allowed to walk around with a gun.
You're not. So there is no permit to carry a gun.
No.
You need to have a permit to have it, and it's only police and
and hunters and.
But the hunters, that would be a long-armed rifle.
Yeah, if you want to buy a gun, you have to get a permit.
It's the same here.
Yeah, but you're not allowed to walk around with it. You can use it when you're shooting tracks and so on, but you're not allowed to walk around with it.
Okay, that's interesting. Mm-hmm. In countries like Albania, Kazakhstan, I mean, are guns a problem?
They have guns, and of course it's a problem, but I don't know about their legislation, but still, of course, it's a problem.
All right. Now, we just have a few minutes left. When you're observing what do you look for and what's the purpose when you observe? I mean, do you come out with a paper after? Do you give suggestions to the country concerned?
Well, we observe what's happening in the polling stations.
Yes.
And we see that people are allowed to vote, that they have not anybody is trying to that it's fair and
what
like
do you
that.
Do with the information?
We will put a report together and okay. Then we will leave it to
I expect us to give the report to Compaq and they will have a report afterwards. The normal thing is that we have recommendations. When I've been out with OSCE and Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, and we have reports and recommendations afterwards. And I expect us to have that as well.
Okay, so. And do things change after the recommendations?
Most of the times they do. Sometimes they just don't care about the recommendations, but I think most countries really want to have fair elections. So I think they should listen to the observers and take that as an opportunity.
All right, we have questions from Twitter for both of you. Georgia Porgia asks, does social media and the internet play a major role in candidates' campaigns in other countries?
Yes, they do.
Yes.
Oh, they do?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes.
I think it's a good way to actually go around the older media, and so it's important everywhere to reach new voters as well.
Yeah. Is Sweden big on social media?
It is.
Is it really?
It's important, yeah.
Okay, all right. Chobat Choi is asking, are political dynasties rampant in other countries?
They have them, of course.
Really?
Yeah.
But not in the same way as you have.
No. I know.
But we have
not in the same way.
Yeah, this is crazy, no?
Yeah.
In what way are political dynasties in the Philippines at a different level than other countries? What are other countries like?
Well, if you compare to Sweden, we don't have those dynasties at all. We have some families that are, you know, where there are many political activists. But they have to be a part of a political party, and then they can come forward.
Okay.
But, you know, it's... I think Philippines is well. It's something of itself.
Mm-hmm.
But you have them in countries like Kazakhstan, Azerbaijan as well. But you can see that if you come from a certain family, it's so much easier. And if you have a president as a father, you know that you will be in a powerful situation.
Yes.
So and have a
but
powerful that,
yes,
position.
I presume that's the norm.
Yeah.
But in the Philippines, you can have someone in national office, your wife is the mayor, your son is the congressman, all at the same time. Yeah. You're all sitting at the same time. Does that happen in other countries?
Not as I have seen it.
I've seen it in countries like Azerbaijan and because in Kazakhstan as well.
Okay, last words, Marie.
I think it's going to be really interesting to see what's going on during election day here in the Philippines. I think I'm so happy to be in your beautiful country.
And you love the sun.
I do. Yeah. I need a sun, so I'm happy to be here.
All right. Leif.
Same with me. I'm very happy to be here. We think we will have an interesting day on May 13, and it will be very interesting to observe how elections really are taking place in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. And I'm amazed that you're wearing like a day barong.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you had this for a long time?
No.
It was literally made for you when you were right?
No. I bought this one when I was at a wedding. One of my associates or friends friends down here.
All right.
It was her wedding in December.
I was going to say you came prepared. Yeah. All right, Leif, thank you so much for coming. And good luck, Marie.
Thank you so much.
All right, I'm curious to hear your views after May 13. That's Head Start today.